It's my pleasure and honor to introduce to you Mrs. Jan Ruff O'Hearn, who could have been a very bitter, angry woman. Many of the women who were taken as sex slaves by the Japanese army couldn't stand the pain and the humiliation, and they took their own lives. For 50 years, hardly anyone knew her terrible secret. The man who proposed to her, Tom, an English soldier, when she told him, he said, "Jan, that makes no difference to my love for you." Her mother knew, some of her family. She continued to have nightmares. Her daughter, a few years ago, said she didn't understand why Mum would get up at 2 a.m. in the morning and go and make cups of tea. And Jan said, "Yes, the nightmares and the terrors still come back." For 50 years, she was silent. For 40 years, the people of God were in the desert before they reached the promised land. Jesus spent 40 days in the desert. The superior general of the Little Brothers of Jesus had a formula for the spiritual life, if you want to go deeply into the spiritual life. His formula was DEN, D-E-N, a desert, Eucharist, Nazareth. He said all contained in that. Jan was faithful during those years of silence. Her faith kept her from becoming a bitter woman. She lost her husband to a traffic accident. In 1992, a Dutch woman who knew what she'd been through asked her, would she come to Tokyo to testify at an international gathering of people demanding rights for the women who'd been taken by the Japanese army. And she went. That was when her daughters first knew about the past of their mother. Jan said she couldn't tell them. She wrote it all down in an exercise book. And when they read it, the two daughters wept very bitterly for 2 weeks. The Australian Broadcasting Commission was at that international gathering in Tokyo, and so overnight Australia knew all about it. And from then on, a remarkable new life began for Jan of witnessing. She spoke for the International Red Cross in Australia and abroad concerning the rights of women hurt in war. She came to New Zealand, spoke in most of the capital of the main cities. She wrote a book. She was asked to write a book about her experiences, and she wrote it in 2 weeks. She put herself inside her house and just wrote that whole book. They sold out very quickly last night, a book called 50 Years of Silence. A deeply moving book. One of her great strengths was her love for St. Francis of Assisi, who also suffered a desert experience before he became the saint that won the heart of the whole world. In 2001, the Dutch government, because originally she was a Dutch citizen who lived in Indonesia, awarded her a very important knighthood of Orange Nassau. The following year, she was made by the Holy Father a Dame Commander of the Order of Saint Sylvester. That year, she was given the Order of Australia. And also, she was made she was awarded the Anzac Peace Prize, because she, who could have been very bitter, became a woman of reconciliation. When Helen and Alex Binney met her at the airport, Helen confessed that she thought she would be meeting someone in a wheelchair after what she'd been through. There's an old saying, the beautiful face of a person aged 20 is a work of nature. A beautiful face of someone aged 70 is a work of grace. Jan chose not to become a bitter, angry woman. She chose to become a woman of reconciliation. And just one final note, you might wonder how I got connected with Jan. I worked in the Marist Mission in Japan. It was begun by a priest, Father Marsden, who was captured at Singapore and worked on that notorious Burma-Thailand railroad, where over one-third of the prisoners died from starvation and bashings. And he kept preaching to the men, "We're Christians, we don't hate." Until one day he was kicked down the railway embankment by a Japanese soldier. And he said he was just consumed with anger, with a real desire, if he could, to throttle that Japanese. And then he went into depression. He said, here I was, a priest. I was now full of hatred. And he felt himself going to pieces. And in the darkness, he said, he asked Jesus forgiveness for hating, and he promised as a sign that he was sincere that he would go to Japan if he survived the war and preach the gospel of love. And that's what he did. And so our mission has been very much connected with reconciliation between Australia and Japan. And 4 years ago, we had a Reconciliation Anzac Day in St. Mary's Cathedral, and we asked Jan, would she come along and speak? And a Japanese movie maker heard about it. Chiba was his name, and he came down with his wife and young daughter, and in the sanctuary of St. Mary's Cathedral, he asked Jan for forgiveness. And she went over and embraced him and his wife and his young daughter. And so instead of a bitter, angry woman standing before you, we have this beautiful 81-year-old Jan, who's still of vitality and who, like her great patron Francis of Assisi, goes around spreading love and reconciliation. Please welcome Jan Ruff O'Hearn.
Thank you, Father Paul, for those kind words. And greetings of peace, love, and joy to all of you here from South Australia, the land of the best wines. It took me, well, before I start my story, I'd just like to thank John Porges for asking me to speak at this convention. I am very honored to speak to you tonight. Seeing you all here this weekend, you are such a witness that the faith is kicking and alive in New Zealand, and congratulations for filling this hall. My story is really a journey of faith. It took me 50 years before I could tell the story you're about to hear, because for 50 years I lived with a terrible shame, a feeling of being different, of being dirty, of being soiled because of what the Japanese did to me during the war. My experience as a woman in war is one of utter degradation, humiliation, and unbearable suffering. During World War II, I was a so-called comfort woman for the Japanese military, a euphemism for military sex slave. I was born in 1923 in Java, the Dutch East Indies, which is now called Indonesia, and I had a most wonderful childhood with a loving family and being brought up with a tremendous faith, a strong faith and a love for prayer. And when the war broke out, my life was torn apart. I was 19 years old when in 1942, Japanese troops invaded the former Dutch East Indies, now called Indonesia, and together with thousands of other women and children, I was interned in a Japanese prison of war camp for 3.5 years. Many stories have been told about the horrors, insults, brutalities, suffering, and starvation of Dutch women in Japanese prison camps. But one story was never told. The most shameful story of the worst human rights abuse committed by the Japanese during World War II. The story of the so-called comfort women and how these women were forcibly seized against their will to provide sexual services to the Japanese Imperial Army. The world ignored these atrocities for almost 50 years. It has taken 50 years for these women's ruined lives to become a human rights issue. Why did it take so long? Perhaps the answer is that these violations were carried out against women. Women are always the innocent victims in war. We have all heard it said, they're only women. This is what happens to women during war. As if rape is part of war, as if war makes it right. Rape in war is a power game. It is used as a reward for the soldiers. In countries like Bosnia and Rwanda, Kosovo, and more recently in East Timor, rape was also used as a weapon and a means to genocide. Rape can never be regarded as an unfortunate byproduct of war. It is indeed a major violation of human rights. I now take you back to the year 1944, February 1944. I had been interned in the Ambarawa prison camp together with my mother and two young sisters for 2 years. I was returning to my barrack from one of my heavy camp duties. Women had to work very hard. Suddenly, there was a great commotion in the camp. A number of Japanese military arrived in army trucks. We were expecting to be called for a roll call or perhaps another inspection. However, this time, the order was given that all single girls from 17 years and up were to line up in the compound. We did not like this command, and we immediately became very suspicious. There was an air of fear throughout the camp, and some girls tried to hide. We were assembled in a long line, and we trembled with fear as a number of high-ranking Japanese military walked towards us. We did not like the look of these Japanese. It was the way they looked us up and down, the way they laughed among each other and pointed at us. We just stood there, frightened, heads down, not daring to look up. The Japanese paced up and down the line looking at us. At times, our chins would be lifted up so they could see our face. Up and down they marched, sneering, pointing, touching. After some discussion among themselves, half the girls were sent away. I was left standing with still a long lineup of girls. My whole body was trembling with fear. The selection process continued until 10 girls were ordered to step forward. The others could go back to their anxious waiting mothers. I was one of the 10. I could hear crying and shouting of the women as they tried to pull us back, and they were fighting bravely with the Japanese, but what could they do? Through our interpreter, we were told to pack a small bag of belongings and report immediately to the front gate where the trucks were waiting to take us away. We were not told any details. The girls and their mothers, and indeed the whole camp, protested with all their might. The entire camp was in uproar, screaming, crying, fighting. It was all in vain. Oppressed and bullied by the enemy, broken and enslaved helplessly by a brutal force, we were sheep for the slaughter. The guards stood over us as we packed a few things, and I shall never forget packing that little case. The first thing I put in my case was my Bible, my prayer book, my crucifix, and my rosary beads. At that moment, they seemed to me the most important things, like weapons. They would keep me safe and strong. Flanked by the guards, we were then taken to the front gate. and we had to say goodbye to our mothers and loved ones. My mother and I could find no words to speak. We looked into one another's eyes and threw our arms around each other. And there, in that moment, it seemed as if we both died in each other's arms. By this time, all the girls were crying as we were forced into the truck. 6 other girls joined our miserable group. A total of 16 girls were then taken from the Ambarawa camp, forced against their will. We huddled together like frightened animals clinging onto our little cases. We had no idea where we would be taken or what was going to happen to us. We soon realized that we were traveling on the main road to Semarang. As we came closer to the city, we drove through the hillside suburb of Semarang, which I knew very well. The truck then stopped in front of a large colonial house. 7 girls were told to get out. I was one of them. We were soon to find out what sort of a house we were forced to live in. Nervously, we kept together as we were ushered into the house by a Japanese officer who seemed to be in charge. Each girl was shown her own bedroom. I could not sleep that night, and neither could the other girls. We all ended up all together in the one big bed, huddled together in fear. And then I led the girls in prayer, and we found strength in praying. The next day, some more Japanese came to the house, and we were all called to the living room. We were made to understand that we were here for the sexual pleasure of the Japanese army. In other words, we found ourselves in a brothel. We were to obey at all times. We were not allowed to leave the house. In fact, the house was guarded, and trying to escape was useless. We were in this house for only one purpose, for the Japanese military to have sex with us. My whole body trembled with fear. My whole life was destroyed and collapsing from under my feet. We protested loudly that we would never allow this to happen to us, that it was against all human rights, and that we would rather die than to allow this to happen to us. The Japanese stood there laughing at us, saying that they were our captors. They could do with us as they liked. And if we did not obey, our families in the camp would suffer. Then they produced papers for us to sign, written in Japanese characters, which we couldn't read or understand. We refused to sign. We were then beaten over and over again, but we did not sign the papers. The following day, we saw the front room of the house being turned into a reception area. We were ordered to have our photographs taken. We all looked at the camera angrily and with sad expression on our faces. These photos were then placed on a pin-up board in the reception area, so that the Japanese could pick the girl of their choice. We were given Japanese names, and flowers were put in our bedroom. I remember throwing the flowers in the back garden, and they were eaten overnight by the snails. A Japanese woman arrived at the house. At last, a woman, I thought. Surely a woman would understand and help us, surely. But the woman showed no pity either. In the meantime, the whole house was being geared up to function as a brothel. Opening night arrived. We were all terrified, and we huddled together in the dining room. We were all virgins, and none of us knew anything about sex. We were all so innocent, and we tried to find out from each other what to expect and what was going to happen to us. My generation was a very innocent generation. Our mothers never told us anything about sex. Girls would still be virgins on their wedding day. As we sat there waiting around the table, fear had completely overpowered our bodies. And even up to this day, I shall never forget that fear. And in a way, it has been with me all my life. I knew that the only thing that could help us now was prayer. And I started to pray with the girls. I opened my prayer book. And often, when you open a prayer book, it always falls on the right prayer. Then I opened my Bible, and it opened on Romans 8. And I read with trembling voice to the girls, "Let us find strength with the Lord. What we suffer in this life can never be compared to the glory which is waiting for us. Nothing can come between us and the love of Christ. Even if we are persecuted, hungry or naked, or being threatened by the sword or even attacked." As we were praying, we could hear the arrival of more and more military coming into the house. We could hear the crude laughter, the boots treading the floor. We were ordered to each go to our bedrooms, but we refused to go. We stayed closely together, clinging to each other for safety. My whole body was burning up with fear. It's a fear I can't possibly describe. It's like electrical currents running through your body, a feeling I shall never forget and lose. And even after more than 50 years, I still experience this feeling of total fear going through my body and through all my limbs, burning me up. It comes to me at the oddest moments. When it gets dark every night at night, when I draw the curtains in my living room, it's getting dark, my whole body starts to burn up with fear, because getting dark meant being raped over and over and over again. I still wake up with nightmares, and I still feel this fear sometimes, just lying in bed at night. The house was now filling up with Japanese. We sat waiting in fear, huddled together, till the time had come and the worst was to happen. One by one, the girls were dragged into their bedrooms, crying, protesting. They pleaded, they screamed, they kicked, they fought with all their might. This continued until all the girls were forcibly taken to their rooms. I hid under the dining room table. I could hear the crying coming from the bedrooms. I could feel my heart pounding with fear. I held tight to my wooden crucifix that I had tucked into my belt around my waist. I'd been wearing the crucifix like this continually. I thought that wearing it might convey some message, but I knew that it would keep me strong. Eventually, I was found and dragged out from under the table. A large Japanese officer stood in front of me, looking down at me, grinning at me. I kicked him on the shins. He just stood there laughing. My fighting, kicking, crying, and protesting made no difference. I screamed, "Don't, don't," and then in Indonesian, "Jangan, jangan." He pulled me up and dragged me into the bedroom. He closed the door, and I ran into the corner of the room. I pleaded with him in a mixture of Dutch, English, Indonesian. Some of them had picked up a bit of the local language. And I tried to make him understand that I was here against my will, that he had no right to do this to me. I stooped down and curled myself up in the corner like a hunted animal that could not escape. Oh, God, help me, I prayed. Please, God, don't let this happen to me. The Japanese officer was in total control of the situation. He had paid a lot of money for opening night, and because we were all virgins, he was obviously annoyed. Consequently, he became very angry. He took his sword out of its scabbard. I'll never forget the sword. He was an officer. It was a beautiful samurai sword. He pointed the sword at me, threatening me with it. I told him that he could kill me, that I was not afraid to die, but that I would not give myself to him. I repeated again, "Jangan, jangan, don't." But he kept pointing the sword at me, touching my body with it, threatening to kill me with it. I pleaded with him to allow to say a few prayers before he would kill me. With his sword touching my flesh, I fell on my knees to pray. I think at that moment, I loved God more than I had ever loved him or anything or anyone ever before. A serene feeling of peace and calm came over me, and I was filled with a strength that could only have come from God. Dear Lord, make me strong as I die for you, I prayed. With Saint Paul, I could say, it is not I that live, but Christ living in me. It's a feeling, it is very hard to express, but Christ had totally taken over in my body. There was no more fear, only strength. I was ready to die. While I was thus praying, the Japanese officer started to undress himself, and I realized he had no intention of killing me. I would have been no good to him dead. He was getting impatient by now, and he threw me on the bed. He tore at my clothes and ripped them off. He threw himself on top of me, pinning me down under his heavy body. I tried to fight him off. I kicked him. I scratched him, but he was too strong. The tears were streaming down my face as he raped me. It seemed as if he would never stop. I can find no words to describe this most inhuman and brutal rape. To me, it was worse than dying. My whole body was shaking. I was in total shock when he eventually left the room. I gathered what was left of my clothing and ran off to the bathroom. I wanted to wash away all the dirt, wash away the shame and hurt of my body. Just wash it away, wash it away. In the bathroom, I found the other girls. We were all in shock and crying, not knowing what to do. We were trying to help each other. We washed ourselves as if it could wash away all that had happened to us. I dare not go back to the dining room. What was I to do? I decided to hide myself, but where? I hid in a room on the back veranda. My whole body was shaking with fear. Not again, I thought. I can't go through this again. But after a while, the angry voices and footsteps came closer, and I was dragged out of my hiding place. The night was not over yet. There were more Japanese waiting, and the terror started all over again. I never realized suffering could be so intense as this. And this was only the beginning, only the first night. At the end of that first horrific night, in the early hours of the morning, 7 frightened, exhausted girls huddled together to cry over lost virginity, to give each other comfort and strength. How many times was each one raped that night? What could we do? We were so utterly helpless. How could this have happened to us? In the daytime, we were supposed to be safe, although the house was always full of Japanese coming and going, socializing, eyeing us up and down. So consequently, we were often raped in the daytime as well. As soon as it was getting dark, the house would be opened, and a terrible fear would burn up my body. Each evening, I tried to hide in a different place, but I was always found, then dragged into my room and severely beaten. I remember one night, I'd used every hiding place I could think of. There was only one left up in the tree. I was a good climber. I climbed high up in this tree, and they couldn't find me, and there was yelling and shouting, and then a torch shone up in the tree, and they found me, and I was dragged out of the tree. But at least it had saved me one rape. One morning, I decided to cut off all my hair to make myself look as unattractive as possible. I found a small pair of scissors in the dressing table drawer, and I cut my hair until I was quite bald. No one would want me like this, I thought. I looked so ugly. But of course, it did not help one bit. The rumor spread that one of the girls had cut off all her hair, and it turned me into a curiosity object. Everyone wanted the girl that had cut off her hair. As the months passed, all of us girls lost weight. We hardly touched our food. We shared our fears and our pains and our humiliations. We were exhausted, and our nerves were stretched to the limit. Continually, we put in a protest to any high-ranking officer that visited the brothel, but it always fell on deaf ears. Each day, I would gather the girls around me to lead them in prayer. They looked to me to give them strength in prayer, and I often think that is why God put me there, so that I could pray with these girls and be their pillar of strength. There was one Catholic girl there, and she was called Lise. And Lise and I, we must have prayed hundreds of rosaries during that time. We found our consolation in praying the rosary together. 50 years later, I met Lise again in Holland. We put our arms around each other. And Lise said to me, "Jan," she said, "remember all the rosaries we prayed." At the end of the night, after having been raped over and over again, the only strength I could get and the only thing that could keep me safe was to pray for the soldiers that had raped me and to pray that prayer of Jesus, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Always and every time the Japanese raped me, I tried to fight them off. Never once did any Japanese rape me without a violent struggle or fight. Often they threatened to kill me. I was severely beaten many, many times. During the fights, I hit out strongly and delivered mighty blows and kicks and scratches, and I injured the Japanese quite often. Because of this, and because of my persistent fights, I was told that if I did not stop the fighting, they would move me to a brothel downtown. For the soldiers, a brothel with native girls, where conditions were much worse. One day, a Japanese doctor arrived at the house. Immediately, I thought that he would be able to help us. Surely, as a doctor, he would have compassion for us. I requested to speak to the doctor, and it was always hard to make ourselves understand. But the doctor showed no interest, no sign of compassion or apology. Instead, the doctor ended raping me on the first day of his visit. In the days leading up to the doctor's visit, gynecological type of equipment had been installed in one of the rooms on the back veranda. From now on, we were to be examined for any possible diseases. Each time the doctor visited us, he would rape me first in the daytime. The worst thing was that the door of the doctor's examination room was always left open. And to humiliate us even more, any other Japanese were allowed to be looking in through the open door or through the windows while we were being examined. They would come into the room or stand at the open door and look at us. This humiliation was unbearable. And after the doctor's visit, I would go to my bedroom and pray the tense station of the cross. Jesus is stripped of his garments. More anxiety came when I missed the period and feared that I was pregnant. I was absolutely terrified. How could I give birth to and love a child conceived in such horror? Like pillars of strength, the girls gave me their support, and they advised me to tell our Japanese woman guard that I thought I was pregnant. Perhaps they would send me back to prison camp to my mother. I approached the woman, and as an answer to the problem, she produced a bottle full of tablets. I could not kill a fetus, not even this one. It would be a mortal sin if I did. I continued to refuse the tablets. Eventually, they were forced down my throat, and I miscarried shortly after. During the time in the brothel, the Japanese had abused me and humiliated me. I was left with a body that was torn and fragmented everywhere. There was not an inch of my body that did not hurt. The Japanese had ruined my young life. They had stripped me of everything. They had taken everything away from me. My youth, my self-esteem, my dignity, my freedom, my possessions, my family. But there was one thing that they could never take away from me, and it was my deep faith and my love for God. This was mine, and nobody could take that away from me. It was my faith in God that helped me survive all that the Japanese did to me, and that I was able to pray. They had really taken everything away from me. Even my clothes were stripped off my body. And yet, I found I was being rich in my poverty. For the first time, I understood what Jesus meant when he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." It means that you are literally stripped of everything. You have got nothing left. There's only you and God. That is poverty. You totally depend on God for everything. And then you get so close to God, I can't describe it. Now I have possessions around me again and cluttered with all sorts of things, but I can still recall those times when I felt so close to God because of utter poverty. St. Francis of Assisi had this same total poverty, and it does bring you very close to God. It was my deep faith that was handed down to me from my father. And to be able to pray, my father taught me how to pray. If you ask me, what do you remember most about your father? My answer would be seeing him at prayer. You know, when your children in the morning, you love to jump into bed with your mom and dad, you know, at some early hour of the morning, you know. You love to come in mom and dad's bedroom. And my memory of my father, that when we went into their bedroom, my father was always in front of the bed saying his prayers. And we children got so impatient with that, you know, we wanted to play with him. And there he was saying his prayers on his knees in front of his, you know, his bed. And then we would jump on his back. And we thought he'd pray for hours, you know. And then eventually, you know, he would stop prayer. But having a memory of that, of your father, isn't that wonderful? And that's what helped me survive, to be able to pray. We cannot live without a prayer life. I have forgiven the Japanese for what they did to me, but I can never forget. And I decided that right from the beginning that I have to be able to forgive the Japanese. And I try to do that every night. It was my deep faith in God that allowed me to survive not only the brutal rape in the brothel, but also the silence which followed it. The silence really started because the Japanese told us if we were to tell anything of this to anybody, they would kill us and kill our family in the camps as well. When the war was over, we were reunited at a certain stage again with our family. I was reunited with my mother. I had to tell my mother what had happened to me. She could not cope with it. This happened to her daughter. It was never talked about again, ever. And I needed somebody to talk to. I also later on talked to my father about it. He couldn't deal with it at all. That was just never talked again. When I met Tom, who was going to be my husband, and we decided to get married, I thought, I must tell Tom. And Tom listened to me. He let me speak, and he listened, never uttered a word. I told him my story. But it was never, ever talked about again. He couldn't cope with it. It was just too much. Nowadays, you can talk about these things. There are counselors, and you can talk. But in those days, people couldn't talk about those things. So it was never talked about. We had to get on with our lives as if nothing had happened to us. I remember when the war was over, for the first time, a priest came to our camp. We were still in prison camp. We couldn't go out anywhere because we had nowhere to go. We were there still in prison camp. And a priest would come to our camp and say Mass after all those years. And I thought, oh, I just want to talk to priest. I had a vocation. I wanted to become a nun. I asked to talk to the priest and I talked to him. I told him my story. And I said, and I still want to become a nun. And his answer was, my dear child, under the circumstances, I think you better not become a nun. So how did that make me feel? It made me feel dirty, soiled, not good enough because of what happened to me. He just told me to forget about it. I don't think any priest would say that to a girl today. In those days, they did. But I never blamed the priest for that. I only realized it was God's will that I was not to become a nun. This is what the priest said. And in those days, you would do what Father says, black or white, you do what Father says. So I did not become a nun. And I think it was all in God's plan I wasn't to become a nun, because I have been able to do so much more for the Lord. You know, not being shut up in a convent like you would be in those days. So there was no counseling, and we just got on with our lives. It was never talked about to anybody. None of my family knew it. My girls didn't know it. And then I was asked to be a witness at an international hearing on Japanese war crimes in Tokyo. in December 1991. In the meantime, in 1991, the war in Bosnia had broken out. Women were again being raped in Bosnia on an organized scale. The Korean Comfort women decided to speak out after 50 years, and they wanted an apology from the Japanese government and compensation. And I watched them on television, and I thought, I must back these women up for their plight for justice. So I said, yes, I will be that witness, and I will go to Japan and tell my story to the world. But the first thing I said to the Japanese before I spoke, I said that I had forgiven them for what they did to me. And you reach much further with forgiveness than if you come with hate and anger. I did not want to waste the suffering after that. Once I'd spoken out, I thought, now I'm going to use it. I'm going to do something with it. God didn't send me all this suffering for nothing. So I decided there and then that I would use my suffering and do something with it. So, and for the past 10 years, with the help of the International Red Cross, who needed a witness, and I have been campaigning for the plight for women, for the protection of women in war, and for human rights for women. So, you see, there's good comes out of everything, even evil. Thank you.